So in this lecture of stress strain behavior, we will study about how the materials behave when we apply stress on them. We studied about different types of stress like normal stress, or you can say longitudinal stress, shear stress. This particular presentation is regarding the normal stress, or you can say axial stresses. There are different type of loading which we study. Always remember that when we study about the stress strain curve, we talk about the gradual loading. Gradual loading means that increases from 0 to some value in an incremental way, like 0, 1, 2, 3, 4. There are other type of loading also, like sudden loading, impact loading. So these are different types of loading. And when we study about tensile test, we talk about gradual loading. So here in the topic stress strain behavior, we consider that our load is a gradual type of load that increases from 0 to a certain level in the incremental manner. So there are different types of engineering materials like ductile materials, brittle materials. They behave differently when the load is applied to them. So their stress strain curve is also different. So let's start with the topic. So before going to the tensile testing, I want to discuss about the sample that we use in the testing. So this particular sample is a round sample that is having some diameter, and this is the standard sample which is used for tensile testing. So this is the setup of tensile testing machine. So you can see that this sample is held here and its change in length is measured with extensiometer. You can see here the lead screws that rotate, which causes the movement of this cross head downwards, which put an axial tensile load on the sample. So this load cell measures the load on the sample, and extensiometer measures the change in length, or you can say the length at a particular time. So as we put on load, extensiometer keep on recording the change in length. So at the end, we use that as a data to generate the stress strain curve. So this particular diagram of sample, you can see that there is a term gauge length. So this is the length we take in the calculations. So this length is under the observation. When we calculate strain, we have to use this formula, that is change in length divided by original length. So this original length is this gauge length, and change in length is given by extensiometer. Stress value is given by load divided by cross section area. So this cross section area is the diameter of the sample, and load is given by the load cell. So from these values, we get the stress strain curve. So you can see here that the area used is the area of the sample. So this is called the initial, or generally we represent it as A naught, because it is initial area of the cross section. So as we perform the test, there is change in length, or you can say if it is axial or tensile load, so there is increase in length, but we know that the volume of the sample is constant. So if L increases, obviously the diameter decreases, but in the calculations we always consider this area of cross section as original area of cross section, and this stress is called engineering stress. So there is another term, true stress, regarding this we will talk at the end of the topic. So the important part of stress strain curve is also Hooke's law. Earlier defined the Hooke's law in our previous lecture also. So within elastic limit, stress is directly proportional to strain. So you can say that stress is a constant times strain. So from here you get that this E is equal to sigma, that is stress by strain. So from the graph you can say that this represents the slope. So here you can see that on one axis we have stress and on another axis we have strain. So the curve is represented by a straight line because it is directly proportional. Stress is directly proportional and the slope is given by sigma by strain. So that slope is called modulus of elasticity. So it's the constant. Modulus of elasticity is a constant and it's the property of a material. Different material have different modulus of elasticity. Depending upon their modulus of elasticity, different material will have different slopes. So under elastic limit means that when we load the material, it will have some strain, and it suppose it reaches this point, and if I remove the load, it unloads to zero strain. That means it regains its original shape and size. Its deformation diminishes. So that means the material comes to its original state. So that limit is of stress is called elastic limit. Now you can see the different values of modulus of elasticity for different materials. For tungsten, the slope will be maximum and the slope will be least for magnesium. So magnesium will have the least slope. Tungsten will have the maximum slope. And as we are discussing Hooke's law, the stress strain curve within the elastic limit will always remain a straight curve. So before going to stress strain curve in detail, you should know some terms, that is elastic deformation. So elastic deformation is the deformation in which stress and strain are proportional. So these are non-permanent. So any change in length that takes place within elastic limit is non-permanent. That means, let's assume that and at particular point O, the value of stress is zero. We start putting the load, the stress starting increasing. Let's assume at particular point A here, at particular point A, the level of stress, let's assume it is 100 megapascals. So at that, the strain means there is some change in length at A. This is the original length. So this gives me the strain. So when I remove the load, within elastic limit, my sigma will again become zero. Strain after unloading will be zero. So this is the case when we talk about the behavior of the material within elastic limit. So that's why elastic deformations are non-permanent. So this plastic deformation is basically due to bending and stretching of the bonds in the crystalline or non-crystalline solids. However, in case of polymeric materials, Elastic deformations may also involve the rotation of bond in addition to stretching and unwinding of the polymer's chain. We have studied about the crystal structures. We know that there are bonds between the adjacent molecules. So these bonds stretch to some level. So due to their stretching, always remember that within elastic limit, these bonds doesn't break, they only stretch. So due to their stretching, we have the elastic deformation. If they break, that means it is non-reversible. So that then the material will shift from elastic to plastic region. So in elastic region, it will only stretch, or it can bend depending upon the situation. So now let's start with the stress strain curve. So stress strain curve is a very important topic in our strength of materials. So it is a graph that is having stress on y-axis and strain on x-axis. If I write the formulas also, so strain is delta L by L and stress is load by A initial. So I can put length initial also. So here you can see that this is the starting point. So when the load is zero, the strain is also zero. As we start loading, the curves start to build, and as we put on the load, the stress will remain proportionate to strain according to Hooke's law. So up to some point you can see that this is the point A. So point A represents proportionality limit. So proportionality limit means the stress is proportional to strain up to this limit. So if we put further load, so the stress will no longer remain proportional. However, there may be condition that it has not achieved the elastic limit. So let point B be the elastic limit. Stress and strain are proportional up to proportionality limit, but the deformations that take place are non-permanent, that is up to elastic limit. So beyond proportionality limit, a material can be elastic, but there is very small difference between these points. So just at the top of this curve, I can see here at point C, the yielding start. Yielding means plastic deformation. So plastic deformation corresponds to breaking of bonds with original atom neighbors and then reforming bonds with new neighbors as large number of atoms or molecules move relative to one another. So if we remove the stress, so there will always remain some permanent deformation. So the material will not regain its original position. So if I suppose, so now up to this I can state that it is elastic limit, elastic region. Beyond this we can say plastic region starts. So if we, let's suppose any point here, then if I unload it, it will go back to the, because when I unload it, that means the force is zero. The level of stress will become zero, but there will be some residual strain left in the material. So that residual strain represents the permanent deformation. So I can also state that the stress corresponding to the intersection of the straight line and the stress strain curve as it bends over in the plastic region is defined as yield strength. So this is, at this, the stress level is at C, it is, the stress level is called yield strength. If I stress the material beyond yield strength, it will start showing plastic deformation, or you can say permanent deformation, when we unload it. So most of the engineering material are loaded up to the yield strength. So the yield strength is a very important term, or you can say a very important level of stress in terms of strength of material, because most of the application of the material in engineering needs the material that shouldn't deform. But if we put the load or the stress beyond this yield stress, then the material will show some permanent deformation that is not required in our engineering materials. So now, after yielding, you can see, say, there is a slight dip in the stress. This is because once the initial breaking of the bonds is initiated, it breaks very swiftly, and immediately without any increase in stress, the change in length takes place very rapidly. So you can see in this region, there is increase in the strain without any increase in the stress level. So point D corresponds to the lower yield point. So C is upper yield point and D is lower yield point. Lower yield point is the lowest stress in the plastic region. The plastic deformations are due to dislocations, and these dislocations are the defects in crystalline materials. So as these dislocations increases in number, they start resisting the further dislocation. So this phenomena is called strain hardening. So due to which the strength of the material increases, and you can say that again the value of stress starts to increase. So if I say unload the material from this point, it will again follow a trend that is parallel to the initial curve. So this will parallel to, again there is some residual strain in that at the unloaded condition. So now if I load it again from this point, it will follow this route, this curve. So you can see that there is new yield strength for the plastically deformed material. So this increase in the yield strength is known as strain hardening. So we increase the strength of the material by plastic deformations. So you have seen number of applications in which this is done. So like in forging process, we have seen that the material is deformed plastically and its strength is automatically got increased. So this region represents strain hardening. This point, let it be E. So point E represents the tensile strength of a material. Tensile strength of the material is the maximum stress the material can undertake before fracture. So as soon as the stress reaches this tensile strength, the cross section, that is earlier regular one, starts to narrowing. So if this is a sample, so cross section starts narrowing. So this phenomenon is called necking. So beyond this, the necking starts. Now you can see that the effective area is reduced. So let it be A dash. So if I compare it with sigma dash is the value of P at that particular level and A dash with engineering stress at that point. So you can see that A naught is greater than A dash. So that means the engineering stress is showing the value that is actually lower than the true stress. So that means there must be, if I draw the true stress strain curve, so it should go in the upward trend. So this upward trend is due to the decrease in the area of cross section due to the necking phenomena. But actually we take it as initial cross section area, so the stress further is going downward. Now this region, the necking takes place, and this is the ultimate, you can say, fracture point. So the material fractures at this point. So this is all about the stress strain curve. So I am again repeating that point A is proportionality limit, point B is elastic limit, point C is upper yield point, point D is lower yield point, point E is tensile strength, and point T is the point of fracture. So now this figure shows the behavior of different material under stress. So one material you can see here, it is not able to show the clear yield point. Here on the another type of material, we can clearly state the yield point. So you can see that its proportionality limit ends at P, then the region starts. But the material, we call it as elastic because if we unload it here, it will go parallel to it and there is very small residual strain. But when there is significant residual strain of 0.002, then we call it yielded. So that means this point corresponds to the yield strength, and at that the strain, residual strain value is 0.002. But on the other stress strain curve, we can see that there is very clear transition from elastic region to plastic region. The material start yielding at this point, let it be Y. And this is called, in this we have two points, upper yield point and lower yield point. So its upper yield strength is given by this point, and then we have lower yield point. So once the start of breaking a bond is initiated, it's the bonds start breaking very abruptly, and it's make new bonds, then break, make new bonds. So this is yield point phenomena. So this elastic plastic transition is very well defined and occurs abruptly in this figure. At the upper point, the plastic deformation is initiated with an actual decrease in stress. Continued deformation fluctuates slightly about some constant stress value, and that is termed as the lower yield point. And after lower yield point, it start increasing, and this is due to the strain hardening. So I already discussed it about strain hardening. I am just repeating it that what is strain hardening. The strain hardening is due to the increase in density of dislocations. So as the dislocation density in a material increases, so it actually, this plastic, or you can say permanent deformations, are due to dislocations. So as they increases, the dislocations multiplication or the formation of new dislocation goes on. So dislocation dislocation interaction are repulsive. So as there is enough dislocations in the material, they disrupt the formation of new dislocations. So this phenomena is termed as strain hardening. So now you can see there is different curves for different type of material. Ductile and brittle are two different classification of materials. Ductile material are those which show a significant plastic region. However, brittle material doesn't show any plastic deformation. They breaks as the stress value reaches yield point. However, the ductile materials yield significantly. They have plastic region. So this is the difference between the brittle and ductile material. So there is an important term, that is ductility. So ductility is the measure of degree of plastic deformation that has been sustained at fracture. A material that experiences very little or no plastic deformation upon fracture is termed as brittle. So it is expressed in terms of percentage elongation or percentage reduction in area. So percentage elongation is the change in length divided by original length. So change in length is, so this is in percentage, change in length is when the material fractures. So then we compare the length by joining it, the fractured sample, we compare the length of the fractured sample by joining it with that of the original sample. So this, that gives us the idea of the elongation. So percentage reduction in area is, we note down the final area of the fractured part and when the final change in area divided by original area will give us a total percentage reduction in area. So these two terms are the measure of ductility. So opposite property of ductility is brittleness. So this particular diagram shows you difference between the engineering stress strain curve and the true stress strain curve. As I have discussed that, as we move from elastic to plastic region, There is some shift from initial cross-section area to actual cross-section area. But in engineering stress, we always consider cross-section area as initial cross-section area. However, in true, we consider as true stress, we consider as true area, that is the area at that instant. So obviously, true stress is greater than engineering stress. So as I discussed, that material fractures when we load it beyond the tensile strength. From the fractured part, you can easily depict whether the sample are of ductile material or brittle. The sample A shows a significant plastic deformation before fracture. You can see there is reduction in area, cross-section area, before fracture. So that means this sample is of a very ductile material. Sample B is having some reduction in area. Some reductions are also there. You can see there here also some plastic permanent deformation, plastic deformations before fracture. So it is of moderate ductile material. Now here there is no plastic deformation. Plastic deformation is completely absent in this sample. So sample C is of a brittle material. So this is A is ductile material. So from the fractured sample, you can easily state which one is of ductile material and which one is of brittle material. So this lecture has introduced you some new terms, that is stress strain curve, then Hooke's law, modulus elasticity is the constant, that is the ratio of stress strain, and it is a constant for a particular material, elastic limit. So these are all terms of stress strain. Then elastic deformation, then the plastic region, we have plastic deformation that remains even when we unload the external load. Then ductility, true stress and strain, strain hardening. So this is about the stress strain curve. Thank you, students.